So if we take, for example, anxiety, the core symptom of anxiety is a fear of loss of control. Once we have this idea, all the behavior, all the anxiety-related behavior falls into place and can be explained by the fear of loss of control, right? Now, you're my client. You came to me and you tell me how miserably you live and how your life is dedicated to take control over your fear of loss of control. And how you do that? OCD, panic attacks, whatever. All these are means that are actually meant to prove to yourself that you are still in control. But I can ask you a very simple question. Knowing that we have good working alliance and you trust me and it's fine, I will ask you a very simple question. When you feel loss of control, what do you control? I can tell you that the first reaction, usual reaction from the client is, what are you talking about? I'm so anxious, I cannot control, I do not control anything. And I keep saying, okay, no anxious. Now tell me, think about that. Get out of the box. Look at yourself from the outside. And tell me, what do you control when you feel loss of control? It's very, very interesting. Sometimes they find the answer right away. Sometimes we take them another session to find the answer. All of them will come with an answer. And the answer is very, not strange. When I feel loss of control, I control my wife. I control my kids. I control my time. I control my responsibilities. And there is a long list of things the person controls when he believes he is not under control. And now think of yourself. You came to your therapist feeling terribly anxious, and then you realize that this anxiety is a powerful meme to control all your environment and yourself. How do you feel about it? The first thing I took from you is the anxiety. The stress level goes down dramatically. Now that you know that when you are not in control, you are actually in control, and there is a person, there's a purpose and a function to your behavior, how do you feel? It's kind of strange, one of my clients had a panic attack every time he went to the supermarket and he stood in front of the cashier, he began having this panic attack. And he was terribly distressed and later on, of course, demoralized and so on. He came to me and asked him, okay, when you feel panic, what do you do? He said, what do you mean? I can't complete the shopping same thing. So what do? I call my wife. And what do you tell them? That I'm having a panic attack and I need help to help me. Well, what did you learn at this point? The panic attack is functional and meaningful and directed to God's wife. So it's not a random, just anxiety-related behavior. It's a relationship-related behavior. And by having panic attack, he controls his wife. Actually, every time he does it, he tests her loyalty, her love. If she comes to help him, to rescue him, then she cares about him. If she doesn't, he's in trouble, right? Once he learned, they learned. This approach, of course, the panic attack disappeared almost immediately. They came back once when his wife wanted to go on vacation to Rome, and he doesn't like flying. So when she proposed going to Rome, he got into a panic attack, and his wife told him, okay, I got the message. You don't want to fly. You don't have to go into panic attack. I understood that immediately, of course, the panic attack disappeared. And they didn't fly to Rome. That's anxiety. Let's say depression. Depression is weakness, helplessness, right? Okay. When you feel weak and helpless, to whom you hold power against? So depression becomes the hopelessness and the weakness is a powerful meme to draw others in. More than that, something we don't do in this context, when we ask a person, okay, you use the word depression. What depression really means for you? You wrote down your definition of depression, right? Did any of you write holiday under definition of depression? Did any of you write vacation under the definition of depression? Nope. Why is that? If you ask people what depression means to them, a lot of times this is what you get. I need a vacation. I can't take it any other way, I get into depression. What a price to pay. Person tell you, I want to be hospitalized. Not because I'm depressed. I want to run away from where I am. I want to take a vacation. The best vacation I can take is in the hospital. People will take care of me, I don't have to be responsible. I can relax any responsibility. I don't have to do anything, just be there, right? Isn't that an excellent way of gaining control over your life? While losing control over your life? When I allow people to explore the meaning of their feelings in such a way, their responses are so varied and interesting, you can't believe. Very few of them fit the book. So if a person comes to you and is depressed and you ask him, look, I believe that behavior is function. What function does aggression serve for? I get this answer. And when I get these answers, what does it mean? One of us is wrong, right? If I think of depression as a problem, as a disability, I'm wrong. Because very likely the other person won't feel like that. Don't be mistaken. I don't take away the pain. I don't take away the suffering. It's there. And it should and needs to be respected. But it's not the only thing that is there. And people know that. We as therapists, not necessarily so, but people know that. They know that in that, what we call abnormal behavior, there's something very normal. We as therapists, educated on the DSM-5, ICD-10, and so on, are not educated to look for them. We are trained to look for symptoms. We are trained to look for maladaptive behavior. We are not looking for adaptive behavior. Not in this way. But try it on your clients. You'll be surprised to see how they feel when you ask them this question. Because this question of what function does your behavior serve is a highly respectful question. It respects your coping abilities. It tells you that what you have and what you do is not random. It serves a purpose, and the purpose is very important for you, for others. I summarize some of the nature of therapeutic dialectics. And if you follow my view, when the issue is office control, you look for control. When the issue is weakness, you look for power. When it's anger, you look for caring. When it's closeness, you look for distance. When it's distance, you look for closeness. And you always find the other side. I use the word always because theoretically, dialectically, it's inherent. It's part of the definition. That's why I'm so sure and certain about what I'm saying, because this is the way it is if you follow the dialectic approach. So when somebody is telling you everything is shine and fun, you know it's not. It's not fair. People are happy and you stick a needle. But if they say that I'm totally depressed, you stick a needle in that too. And you say, when you are so depressed, what function does it serve? What good is it in feeling so depressed? You legitimize the person, you legitimize the behavior. And then you ask the person to think more deeply and come back with an answer the person did not think about. Or he thought about that, but he was afraid to tell anybody because it does not fit with the model. You cannot be depressed and powerful at the same time. Certainly you cannot admit to that loudly. Because if you admit to that loudly, you can either be depressed or powerful, but not both. Because this is the issue of dialectic thinking. It's not logical. Logic says that X and not X cannot live together. They cannot be together. Either you are black or white, You cannot be both black and white. That's logic. That's not dialectics. Dialectics says, yeah, you can be both black and white. You can be depressed and happy at the same time. And it's very interesting because part of my work is research, and a lot of my research is done with Akel. And I found over the years that affect can be divided roughly into two. Don't laugh at me, but you'll see in a minute why I'm saying that. Positive and negative affect. Positive and negative affect, methodologically and statistically, are orthogonal to each other. They don't relate to each other. The correlation between the two is almost zero. However, and maybe that's what it represents, people can experience both positive and negative affect simultaneously. So they can mark on the questionnaire, which describes your mood at that moment, that you have high negative and high positive mood at the same time. Logically, it doesn't make sense, right? If we think about how we feel one feeling at a time, right? Not two opposing feelings at the same time. When we do that, we feel confused because we don't know which one is right. And we cannot accept the fact that, yeah, I mean, it's okay that both coexist at the same time. So dialectic thinking is not logical. Nevertheless, once you get the idea that black and white can coexist, it becomes logical. Then you can use the rationality to understand whatever you like. But the basic premise is you can be powerful and helpless at the same time. You can be out of control and under control at the same time. The only thing is that you need to point the light in the right direction. So you can understand and accept that you can hate and love your spouse at the same time, and it's okay. Not only is it okay, but both represent caring. So love and hate are actually the same. Wow, isn't it? Now you come to a client with that, you confuse him terribly, but by confusing him, you actually get him out of confusion. Well, I must admit that my schedule is totally blown off, but what I'm ready to do, if one of you is volunteer to work late, we can sit together and chat for about how as long as it takes, and I can demonstrate how it works. Anybody?
I have a question.
Sure.
Is there any data on the success rate of using this one? Is there any data on the success rate of using this
one? In the book and in the paper, I passed the first stage of evidence-based. I have about 50 cases. It's coming. Documented. I have many more I treated, but I have over 50 cases documented in the literature that serve the first phase of the evidence-based